name is Anna Catley, and this is a visual essay about Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu. It's not easy to compare Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu at first glance. An Ozu film appears quiet and humble, the meandering river to Wes Anderson's rapids. An Anderson film thrives with action, where an Ozu film has an undeniable reverence for minimalism and simplicity. Anderson is obsessed with ornamentation and artificiality, and Ozu approaches his subjects with realism. But however at odds these two styles might appear at first glance, what I'll be doing is looking at similar visual and thematic occupations. I'd like to iterate that this essay is conjecture. I'm not saying that Wes Anderson was influenced by Yasujiro Ozu, and I'm not trying to stress an innate inseparability between them. This is simply taking what I know of Anderson, and taking what I know of Ozu, and playing with some parallels, and in the process, learning a bit more about these two film greats. You know you're watching a Wes Anderson film when you see elements of nostalgia, color palettes of yellow and blue and pink, Futura font. You'll recognize the instances of dark humor, and the almost detached way in which the actors deliver their lines.
Your cat's dead.
You'll also see recurring faces. Owen Wilson, Bill Murray, Jason Schwartzman, and others. You know you're watching an Ozu film when you see the opening titles against a burlap mat, scenes shot from below called a tatami mat shot, lingering shots on objects and scenery between scenes of dialogue, and you'll notice splashes of red. You'll also recognize Chishu Ryu and Setsukohara. So we know what's distinct about each director, but let's look at some attributes that these two directors share. There's a strong focus in Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu films on the family house, or architecture, that could be easily dissected. Take, for instance, Susie's home in Moonrise Kingdom. Anderson likes to travel through sets to create spatial awareness and to isolate certain goings-on. We can see this as well in the Belafonte scene in The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou, and with the Tenenbaum house in The Royal Tenenbaums. Ozu, likewise, likes to firmly root his stories in spaces that he can easily travel through. Similarly to Wes Anderson, Ozu likes to create symmetry within his living space. Another visual parallel that's easy to spot is the usage of the medium close-up, where we have characters fully facing the camera, as if they were speaking directly to the viewer. We can already see that there are quite a few visual parallels between the films of Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu. But the core of this cinematic relationship is in an exploration of themes and narratives. One of the most prominent tropes in Anderson and Ozu's works are ones of family and children, specifically parent-child relationships. The Life Aquatic, The Royal Tenenbaums, Fantastic Mr. Fox, and Moonrise Kingdom all feature strained parent-child relationships. We see this with Steve and Ned fighting over Jane in The Life Aquatic, Royal and Etheline finding themselves out of touch with their children in The Royal Tenenbaums, and Susie not being understood by her parents in Moonrise Kingdom. Tokyo Story, Good Morning, and A Story of Floating Weeds have parents and children at odds with one another as well. We also see fathers and daughters butting heads over marriage in many Ozu works, including, but definitely not limited to, An Autumn Afternoon and Late Spring. In that same vein, the trend in Ozu films is the dissolution of the family. Sometimes a parent is missing or dead, and sometimes the film ends with a marriage, an implied separation of child and parent, like with An Autumn Afternoon. Wes Anderson utilizes the dissolution of the family as well, although his conclusions are considerably more optimistic. bringing children and parents together instead of pulling them apart. In any case, the turbulences of family take center stage in both the works of Yasujiro Ozu and Wes Anderson. Young children as well are utilized by both directors, which oftentimes adds a sense of innocence to a film with otherwise serious themes. With Anderson, we see this in Rushmore with Dirk.
And then I knew for sure when they went skinny dipping in Mr. Bloom's swimming pool, giving each other hand jabs while you were taking a nap on the front porch.
And with Sam and Susie in Moonrise Kingdom. With Ozu, a prominent example of this is with the little boy in A Story of Floating Weeds from 1934, and Floating Weeds, the 1959 remake. The story is fairly melancholic in tone, but the antics of the little boy offer little moments of comic relief. Good Morning is already lighthearted by nature, but there's still something to be said for the way in which Ozu lingers on these little moments of fun and whimsy. Another element that's hard to ignore in both Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu's films is a sentimentality for nostalgia. Wes Anderson especially is known for his creation of environments which feel timeless with all of its borrowed elements from other time periods. We see this in the color palettes and patterns in the Royal Tenenbaums that are strongly reminiscent of the 60s and 70s, suggesting a family stuck in time. We can also see this with Max's play being set during the Vietnam War in Rushmore. And in the soundtracks, we experience that nostalgic longing with tracks from 1960s and 70s bands and singers, such as The Kinks, Paul Simon, Nico, Cat Stevens, Bob Dylan, and others. Throwbacks through music are used by Ozu as well in Floating Weeds and especially in An Autumn Afternoon, where the same grand war tune is sung multiple times throughout the film. But Ozu didn't focus on recent nostalgia like Anderson does. But rather, Ozu placed emphasis on the familiar by cultivating a sense of tradition. We can see this with a strong focus on objects and images traditional to Japanese culture, such as tea ceremonies, kabuki theater, and religious objects, such as this Buddhist Daruma doll in A Story of Floating Weeds. Another thematic parallel we can draw between Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu is the cyclical nature of their respective narrative structures, having films end where they started. The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou opens with Steve presenting the first part of his jaguar shark documentary to a less than enthusiastic reception. The Life Aquatic ends with a screening of the complete work. At this point, Steve has observed the jaguar shark, has gained and then lost a son, and is now being heralded for a comeback. We're brought back to almost the exact same situation as the opening of the film, but everything has changed. We see the same use of cyclical structure in The Grand Budapest Hotel, which opens on a young girl visiting the author's statue, the book of The Grand Budapest Hotel in hand. And the film ends in the same way, with the same girl reading, or maybe just having finished reading, the story we've just been told. Ozu also has a tendency to end his films where they began. Donald Ritchie said of Ozu, "Just as a sequence in Ozu is circular, so is the basic form of the entire picture. It would be difficult to find an Ozu film that did not end where it began." This can be applied to A Story of Floating Weeds and Floating Weeds, where both begin with the arrival of a kabuki troupe in the village, and both films end with the departing of the kabuki troupe. The way in which the plot is constructed, ending where the story began, feels harmonious in its joining of two loose ends to create a full circle. Similarly, Tokyo Story has its protagonists, a husband and wife who are visiting their children and grandchildren in Tokyo, start the story in their country home with their neighbor, and has the film ending in the same manner with the exact same neighbor. The return to a known ground is surprisingly fresh, and you cannot help but feel grateful for this return to the beauty of the familiar. Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu have a lot in common, but in the end, what's really similar about Wes Anderson and Yasujiro Ozu is a Wes Anderson film always looks like a Wes Anderson film, and a Yasujiro Ozu film always looks like a Yasujiro Ozu film.
Yes!
But now, with tens of years between Ozu's final film, An Autumn Afternoon, and Anderson's first film, Bottle Rocket, it's interesting to run a fine-tooth comb through their respective filmographies, and for cinema's sake, try and find those subtle nuances that create connections between two completely different, yet surprisingly similar directors.